Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
We gather to commend Walter to his rest in Christ.
This is the last act of charity that we can give to him, for we trust in the hope of the promise Jesus made to abide with him until the day of resurrection.
Therefore, even in the midst of our grief, we can still echo the words God's people have always declared. Rejoice in the Lord, O you righteous.
For the word of the Lord is upright, and all his work is done in faithfulness.
Truly the eye of the Lord is on those who fear him, on those who hope in his steadfast love, to deliver them from death.
Our soul waits for the Lord, he is our help and shield. Our heart is glad in him, because we trust in his holy name.
Let your steadfast love, O Lord, abide with us, as we hope in your word.
Amen.
Lift high the cross, the love of Christ proclaim, till all the world adore his sacred name.
Come, Christians, follow where our captain trod.
Our King victorious, Christ, the Son of God. Lift high the cross, the love of Christ proclaim, till all the world adore his sacred name.
All newborn servants of the crucified,
bear on their brows the seal of him who died. Lift high the cross, the love of Christ proclaim, till all the world adore his sacred name.
O Lord, once lifted on the glorious tree,
as thou hast promised, draw us all to thee. Lift high the cross, the love of Christ proclaim, till all the world adore his sacred name.
So shall our song of triumph ever be.
Praise to the crucified for victory. Lift high the cross, the love of Christ proclaim, till all the world adore his sacred name.
Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray.
Gracious God, come, be with us now as we gather around the hope of our faith. Enliven our minds with the memories we share. Console our hearts with the confidence of your favor for Walter. Bring us peace. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Please join me in the hymn for the lighting of the Advent wreath. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. When I feel afraid, think I've lost my way, still you're there right beside me. And nothing will I fear as long as you are near. Please be near me to the end. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. I will not forget your love for me, and yet my heart forever is wandering. Jesus, be my guide and hold me to your side. I will love you to the end. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path.
A reading from Genesis. In the day that the Lord God made the earth and the heavens, when no plant of the field as yet was in the earth, and no herb of the field had yet sprung up, for the Lord God had not caused it to rain upon the earth, and there was no one to till the ground, but a stream ascended out from the ground and watered the whole face of the earth. Then the Lord God formed man from the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. And the man became a living being. And God said, "You are dust, and to dust you shall return." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us read Psalm 18 responsibly. The Lord is my rock, my fortress, and my deliverer, my God, my rock in whom I take refuge, my shield and the source of my salvation, my stronghold.
I call upon the Lord, who is worthy to be praised. So shall I be saved from my enemies.
Though the cords of death encompassed me, the torrents of perdition assailed me, the cords of hell entangled me, the snares of death confronted me.
I called upon the Lord. To my God I cried for help.
His way is perfect. The promise of the Lord proves true.
He is a shield for all who take refuge in him.
For who is God except the Lord? And who is the rock besides our God?
God, who girded me with strength and made my way safe.
The Lord lives.
Blessed be my rock, and exalted be the God of my salvation.
A reading from Revelation. And to the angel of the church in Philadelphia write, though these are the words of the Holy One, the True One, who has the key of David, who opens and no one will shut, who shuts and no one opens. I know you keep my word, I know your works. Look, I have set before you an open door, which no one is able to shut. I know that you have but little power, and yet you have kept my word and have not denied my name. Because you have kept my word of patient endurance, I will keep you from the hour of trial that is coming on the whole world to test the inhabitants of the earth. I am coming soon. Hold fast to what you have so that no one may seize your crown. If you conquer, I will make you a pillar in the temple of my God. You will never go out of it. I will write you on the name of my God and the name of the city of my God, the new Jerusalem that comes down from my God out of heaven, and my own new name. Let anyone who has an ear listen to what the Spirit is saying to the churches. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please join us in the verse hymn responsibly. We are marching in the light of God.
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 We are marching, marching.
We are marching.
We are marching in the light of God.
We are marching.
We are marching. We are marching in the light of God.
We are dancing 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 in the light of God.
We are dancing, dancing.
We are dancing, oh, oh.
We are dancing in the light of God.
We are dancing, dancing.
We are dancing, oh, oh.
We are dancing in the light of God. We are praying in the light of God.
We are praying in the light of God.
We are praying in the light of God.
We are praying in the light of God.
We are praying, praying.
We are praying.
We are praying in the light of God.
We are praying, praying.
We are praying, oh, oh.
We are praying in the light of God.
We are singing 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 in the light of God.
We are singing, singing.
We are singing, oh, oh.
We are singing in the light of God.
We are singing, singing.
We are singing, oh, oh.
We are singing in the light of God. Holy Gospel according to John, the 14th chapter. Then Jesus told them a parable. The farm of a certain rich man was abounding. And he spoke to himself, saying, "What will I do? For I have no place to gather my crops." Then he said, "I will do this. I will demolish my barns and build larger ones. And there I will gather all my grain and my goods. And I will say to my soul, 'Soul, you have ample goods laid up for many years. Relax, eat, drink, be made merry.' But God said to him, 'Fool, this very night your soul is being demanded of you. And now, what you have planned out, things you have prepared, whose will they be?' Such is the one storing up for themselves and not being rich toward God." Jesus said to his disciples, "Therefore, I tell you, do not be anxious about your life, about what you may eat or about your body, what you may wear. For life is more than food, and the body more than clothing. Consider the ravens. They neither sow nor reap. They have neither storehouse nor barn, and yet God feeds them. How much more are you worth than the birds? And can any of you, by worrying, add a single hour to your span of life? If then you are not empowered to do so small a thing, why do you worry about the rest? Consider the lilies, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. Yet I tell you, even Solomon in all of his glory was not clothed like one of these. But if God so clothed the grass of the field, which is alive today and tomorrow is being thrown into the oven, how much more will he clothe you, you of little faith? And you, do not seek what you may eat and what you may drink, and do not be made wobbly. For it is the nations of the world that strive after all of these things, and your Father knows that you need them. Instead, seek his kingdom, and these things will be given to you as well. Have no fear, little flock, because it pleases your Father to give you the kingdom. Sell off what is sustaining you and give charity. Make yourselves purses that are not becoming obsolete, an inexhaustible storehouse in the heavens where no thief comes near and no moth destroys. For where your storehouse is, there your heart will be." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Now we have some folks who have some remembrances to share.
To many, my dad was known as Red, Red Rover. That was his CB handle. The Marine, the Cleveland Indian fan, or the Montreal Canadian fan. To me, he was my hero and inspiration. The Marine's motto is to adapt, improvise, and overcome. Throughout his life, he certainly followed this motto. Not sure if any of you know this, but my dad didn't know how to swim, and he never learned. But that didn't stop him from going into pools and lakes and floating on his back. He obviously didn't stay afloat for too long because he was too skinny. But that was one obstacle he learned to overcome. Another event, or should I say events, he had to adapt to came in 1972. That's the year my parents' lives changed forever. Wally, Joanne, and I were all born. After they adopted Wally in March, they were only expecting one baby in November, but they were surprised with twins. My mom and dad figured out a way with the help from family and friends to take care of three babies at once, which I'm sure wasn't easy. They made the most of it and did what they needed to do to give us the best lives they could. The way they raised the three of us influenced us how we are as parents now. However, the biggest challenge came when he was diagnosed with lung cancer in April 2014. For someone who had never had any major surgery before in his life, this was going to be a huge barrier that he was going to have to get over. At first, it was a struggle, but he knew that he wanted to fight it. He wanted to beat cancer and didn't want cancer to beat him. Because he was diagnosed at an older age, we knew it was going to be a harder fight, but that didn't stop him either. So he did what he had to do and kicked cancer's, well, I want to say a word, but I'm in church. So he kicked cancer's butt. By conquering so many things in his life and not giving up, he taught me to do the same even before he had to fight cancer. His inspiration and willpower helped me get through my own cancer and the loss of my infant son. I know I will miss him, but I know that he is at peace. On behalf of my family, thank you all for being there for my dad during the past several years. I know that he appreciated it, and so did we. Semper Fi, Dad.
Carol's asked me to invite anyone else who would like to come up and share a remembrance about Walter. Pastor?
Pastor Chris and I were commiserating before this liturgy began, and we talked about family members and friends who volunteered to come up and share a eulogy, it means a good word in Greek, about their loved one, a friend who had died. We both said we've heard a lot of strange eulogies, a lot of things that daughters and sons have said or wives have said that might have been inappropriate, but people grieve in different ways. But what Dorothy had to say was truly beautiful. So thank you for that. It's good to be back here at Grace. It's good to see this olive wood again. I was with Dory Gretscher about 25 years ago when she purchased that olive wood creche in Bethlehem, of all places. The shopkeeper was an honest man, and he wanted to make sure that whatever it was that Dory purchased, he would ship it back to the States, and he would mark it clearly to know that what she ordered, she received. And so he had Dory on the bottom of each of these crush figures put her initials, And it's still there, Dori Gretchen. Just her initials. Turns out that when we got these, Dori didn't notice, but what she had ordered and paid for was about this high, and this is what we got. So, you know, even Holy Land shops have to make a nickel, and he did just that. But when I saw those initials, I thought to myself, that old verse from Isaiah saying, "Behold, before you were born, I have called you by name." God calls us by name and not by our initials. It's not W.S. I've called you by name before you were born, W.S. No, Walter Straub. And God means what God says. Walter was a fixture here at Grace for about 2 decades. And he was here almost more than I, because his wife was here more than I. She was here for all kinds of events and group meetings and so on and so forth. Walter was here too. Not necessarily because he wanted to be, but he drove Miss Daisy. And so he was here along with her. And he did so gladly. And he was always glad to be here at Grace. He and I shared some tough moments together. For a while, we were both on external oxygen. I had a little oxygen case that was over my shoulder. He had the premier oxygen
concentrator.
Boy, it's nice to forget words like that. Oxygen concentrator. It was on wheels. He could draw it around much better than mine. His could deliver 6 liters of oxygen a minute. Mine only 5 liters of oxygen per minute. And he never let me forget that, the humble man that he was. He was a good man. He was a busy man when he was here. Even after he was so ill and I got rid of my oxygen, he did not get rid of his until the very end, when his breathing stopped. But he always had a calm demeanor. There was only one time I saw him upset. I met him in the hospital at Mount Sinai in the city more than once, but my friend Marvin Hank was with me one day, and it must have been soon after he got a diagnosis that was quite bad, and he let his emotions flow. That was the only time I saw him lose it in that way. In public, at least, he put on a happy face, and he had a happy face. He was a good man. Any of you remember that song by the Birds, "Turn, Turn, Turn"? A lot of people know Ecclesiastes chapter 3 when they hear it. "For everything there's a season, a time for everything under heaven, time to be born, time to die." But in our culture, where the Bible is not quite so well known, a teenager, young adult might hear that and think, "Oh, that's from the Birds. That's for the Birds." They don't understand it comes from Holy Scripture. A time for everything, a season for everything under heaven. April of 1938, a time to be born. November of 2020, a time to die. Walter knew the writing on the wall. And again, at least in public, he always put on a happy face. He knew under heaven that his place was soon to be above heaven, within heaven. And that faith gave him confidence, gave him courage. He was a Marine, ex-Marine. A lot of courage comes from being a Marine. You learn courage. You just don't make it up.
I was in the Air Force. He was in the Marines. I would tell him he ought to thank me, the Air Force, and I hope the honor guards can't hear this. He would thank me for, at least I thought he should thank me for, guarding the men on the ground. I was in the Air Force. I was a chaplain's assistant. I was never up in a plane. But nevertheless, I let him know that he owes the Air Force a debt of gratitude. Never once hit me. I don't know if his Marine brethren might not take this so. They don't know my sense of humor, I guess. We talked about the military and our days serving the country. And then we talked about something very close to our hearts, our faith, to be sure. We talked about faith. Our families, to be sure. We talked about our families. But one other thing, close to our hearts, we often chatted about. Let me close with a quick story. It happened January 21st, 1776. A pastor standing in the pulpit. Peter Muhlenberg, standing in the pulpit of Woodstock, Virginia, the little church where he served. He was a good pastor. He's known as the father of Lutheranism in the United States. He was a man not afraid to speak his mind. There's a time for war, a time for peace. He knew the scriptures well. And Sunday, It was January 21st, 1776. Muhlenberg was preaching on the verses from the teacher, Ecclesiastes chapter 3. Time to be born, time for to die, a time for peace, a time for war. And when he said that, he kind of went like this, and he opened his alb, pulled it wide, and underneath was the uniform of the Continental Army. It was his way of saying, there's a time to preach and there's a time to fight. And he went on to become a colonel in the Army of Freedom for the United States. I read that story a while ago, and I thought that might be a cool way to end my bit of eulogy about my good friend Walter. But Muhlenberg, if I had the guts, I'd go like that, tear this off. And it's not my Air Force uniform by any means, but Walter and I were co-founders of the Cleveland Indians fan club here at Grace. We were the only two members at the beginning, the only two members, and at the end, the only two members. And now I am alone, but I know that Walter is by my side. So on behalf of the family, thank you all for being here. You all knew him in different ways and could tell different stories, better stories than I just did. But he's in your heart, he's in my heart, and he's in the arms of Almighty God. Amen.
Pastor Helm, I hope you don't mind if I say a few things while you're getting dressed again.
Right ahead.
Thank you. Hold fast to what you have so that no one may seize your crown. I wish I had known that this was Walter's confirmation verse, because I'd have a couple of questions for him. And I certainly would have had plenty of time to ask him these questions, because as Pastor Kennedy said, he was always around. One of the questions I would ask him is not whether he had the confirmation verse memorized, because clearly he did, which is why he didn't have it memorized.
No.
How did you know it?
Because when I
when I asked him for it, he said, I don't have one.
Oh.
And then I found his book and I said, guess what? Here it is.
Well, there you go. So he didn't have it memorized. That's too bad.
I know mine memorized. I know mine.
All right, well, I'll remember that when we're doing your eulogy. So. You have yours memorized. Well, Walter, it would not surprise me if Walter had it memorized, because one thing I remember about Walter is that he had an encyclopedic memory, even if it got a bit spotty in the last few months. But if I could ask Walter about his confirmation verse and remind him what it was, I'd also ask him what he thought about it. Because I find it to be a very powerful Lutheran verse that describes what the Christian life is all about. I like how it begins by saying that we are to hold fast to what we have, because it means we have it. It's not something that we have to work to gain. It's not something we just hope to get lucky and find or receive. We have it. It's been given to us. And there is nothing more we need to do other than, as Walter's verse says, hold on to it. We need to only cling to what we already have. I like also that we're not to hold fast to what we've been given because we might otherwise misplace it, like that car keys that keep getting lost, or the iPhone I was sure I left in my office but found in the bathroom. Walter's verse assures us that what we have been given, we cannot lose. But what can happen, according to Walter's verse, is that it might be taken away from us, which is usually how it goes. Something comes along, some situation comes up, something tempts us to let go. Let go of what we've been given. And then we're left with nothing. This is where I think Walter really lived out his confirmation verse, even if he didn't know he was doing it. Because despite all of the things that happened to him, despite all of the opportunities that came along, all of the temptations to let go, Walter faithfully held fast to what he was given. Held fast in faith, held fast in hope, held fast in love, always. Now, I know that in Walter's verse, it talks about how what we are holding on to is a crown. And of course, the first thing that we think of when we think of a crown is the thing that royal people wear on their heads. Maybe not so much these days, but you know, on special occasions, the queen still wears a crown. But maybe we don't need to be quite so literal. I mean, if Walter was to recite his confirmation verse in front of an American Methodist Episcopal church full of black congregants, and they heard the word crown, they might think of the hats that the women wear to church, beautiful hats. But since Walter was not an Anglican who worries about royalty, nor an American Methodist Episcopal who would be interested in the hats in the rows in front of him. But because Walter was a Lutheran, someone where hats and crowns have long gone out of fashion, I propose that instead Walter's verse is referring to our halo. You know, that gold thing that's above the heads of saints in all those pictures? Which indeed Walter was. A saint. But not because of his faithfulness, not because of his good works, not because of his endurance or his love. But even in the face of his shortcomings in these things, he was still a saint, because as Walter's confirmation verse says, his halo, his sainthood, his identity as God's child was something that was given to him. Given out of God's grace and love for him. And so I'm certain that Saint Walter is wearing that halo now. For in life he lived out his confirmation verse, whether he knew it or not. He held fast to the identity and the calling that God had given to him in his baptism, given to him. And he never let anyone or anything seize it and take it away. Please join us in reciting responsibly the hymn of the day. A mighty fortress is our God, a sword and shield victorious. He breaks the cruel oppressor's rod and wins salvation glorious. The old satanic foe has sworn to work us woe. With craft and dreadful might, he arms himself to fight. On earth he has no equal.
No strength of ours can match his might. We would be lost, rejected.
But now a champion comes to fight, whom God himself elected.
You ask who this may be. The Lord of hosts is he.
Christ Jesus, mighty Lord, God's only Son adored. He holds the field victorious.
The hordes of devils filled the land, all threatening to devour us.
We tremble not, unmoved we stand, they cannot overpower us.
Let this world's tyrant rage, in battle will engage.
His might is doomed to fail, God's judgment will prevail. One little word subdues him. God's word forever shall abide, no thanks to foes who fear it. For God himself fights by our side, with weapons of the Spirit. Were they to take our house, goods, honor, child, or spouse, or life be wrenched away, they cannot win the day. The kingdom's ours forever. Church, the faith in which Walter was baptized. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And now let us pray together as God's people, responding after each petition with, "Hear our prayer."
Lord Jesus Christ, by your cross and empty tomb, you have turned the darkness of death into the path to light. You have transformed its finality into a temporary rest. For being our salvation, our hope, and our source of life, we give you thanks and praise. Risen Christ,
hear our prayer. Lord Jesus Christ, forgive us when our thoughts, fears, and experiences weaken our trust in you. Make us certain that we will never forget, you will never forget or forsake us. Give us the faith to believe that because you live, we shall live also, and that neither death nor life, nor things present nor things to come shall be able to separate us from your love. Risen Christ,
hear our prayer.
Lord Jesus Christ, we give you thanks for the life and work of Walter, your faithful servant, for the blessing of his love for his family, for the blessing of his friendship, for the blessing of his service to your church and the community. We give thanks and prayer and pray that he will remain alive in the hearts of all of us who knew him, as you reward him with the peace he now deserves. Risen Christ,
hear our prayer.
Lord Jesus Christ, we ask your peace to also be upon those who mourn and grieve. Surround them with the support they need, and care for them in their sorrows this day and for the years to come. Risen Christ,
hear our prayer.
Lord Jesus Christ, out of your tender love for us all, send the Spirit to those who are dying or awaiting death this day. Give them the peace that only you can give, the hope that only you can offer, and comfort that only your abiding presence can bring. Risen Christ,
hear our prayer.
Lord Jesus Christ, support us all the day long of this troubled life, until the shadows lengthen and the evening comes and the busy world is hushed. The fever of our life is over and our work is done. Then, in your mercy, grant each of us safe lodging and a holy rest and peace at the last. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
God be with you till we meet again.
God be with you till we meet again.
By his counsel's guide uphold you, with his sheep securely fold you.
God be with you till we meet again.
Till we meet, till we meet, till we meet at Jesus' feet.
Till we meet.
Till we meet. God be with you till we meet again. God be with you till we meet again. Neath his wings protecting hide you. Daily manna still divide you. God be with you till we meet again. Till we meet, till we meet, till we meet at Jesus' feet. Till we meet, till we meet. God be with you till we meet again.
God be with you till we meet again.
When life's perils thick confound you, put his arms unfailing around you.
God be with you till we meet again.
Till we meet, till we meet, till we meet at Jesus' feet. Till we meet, till we meet. God be with you till we meet again. God be with you till we meet again. Keep love's banner floating o'er you. Smite death's threatening wave before you. God be with you till we meet again. Till we meet, till we meet, till we meet at Jesus' feet. Till we meet, till we meet. God be with you till we meet again.